next on Unsolved Mysteries. 18-year-old Kaitlyn Arquette is brutally gunned down, and her mother tries to find the killer. A serial rapist is on the loose at a highly respected university. New evidence found on a remote island might explain what happened to legendary aviator Amelia Earhart. And a woman claims she is living proof that reincarnation is real. And the facts may back her up. These are stories with intriguing secrets and surprising revelations. So stick around. I'm Dennis Farina, and for the next hour, this is Unsolved Mysteries. Albuquerque, New Mexico, 10:45 p.m. 18-year-old Kaitlyn Arquette has just finished dinner with her girlfriend.
She told us she'd had a big fight with her boyfriend. She was breaking up with him, and she was going to a girlfriend's house for dinner. And she would either spend the night there or come back and spend it at our house. She was not going to go back to the apartment. Before midnight, the phone rang. It was a phone call from the emergency room of the hospital. They said, Kate is there, that she's been injured. And I said, what's happened? And they said, we can't tell you on the phone. So my husband and I drove to the hospital, and Kate had been shot twice in the head. She was in a coma.
5 hours later, police arrive at Kate's apartment. Her live-in boyfriend is home, alone, seemingly unaware that his girlfriend has been shot and is close to death.
We're with the Albuquerque Police Department. Just like, come in, talk to you a minute.
Sure, what's this about?
Kaitlyn's boyfriend told me that he had been out with a couple of friends. They had eaten, they'd played pool, and they had a couple of drinks.
A couple of buddies of mine.
While I was there, myself and the other detectives, we discovered a note on top of the kitchen table, and the note read something to the effect, hon, I'll be home at a certain time, that sort of thing.
Kaitlyn, she left that for me.
When the police leave the apartment, Kate's boyfriend goes straight to the hospital and joins her family at her bedside. But by the next day, Kaitlyn Arquette is dead.
6 months after Kaitlyn's murder, police concluded that she had been the victim of a, quote, random act of violence. But her mother refuses to accept that ruling. She is convinced that her daughter was executed by a hired assassin.
We're all set. No questions asked.
2.5 months before she was killed, Kaitlyn and her boyfriend took a trip to Southern California. Apparently, Kate had become involved in a complex insurance scam.
One of our daughters told me that March, a couple of months before, the boyfriend had staged an accident, a fake accident, in a car that Kate had rented for him with our credit card.
The scam was reportedly set up by a Vietnamese gang. Everyone involved in the accident would complain of soft tissue injuries to their neck and lower backs, and were later treated by a doctor who was also part of the fraud. Ultimately, a law firm in Orange County, California, handled all the insurance claims. Kate and her boyfriend received $1,500 as their share of the settlement.
Everything went well.
It was a major multi-million dollar insurance scam. all of a sudden, there was another element there, something that suggested a possible motive. Because if Kate was breaking up with her boyfriend at that time, then maybe she was a danger to the people who had arranged this.
A few weeks after Kate's death, her mother made a disturbing discovery. Three calls had been made from Kate's apartment at almost the exact time that she died.
In fact, they were made just minutes after she was pronounced dead, when her boyfriend was with us at the hospital, and the apartment should have been unoccupied. The number turned out to belong to a Vietnamese paralegal in Orange County, and it was the same paralegal who set up the car wrecks.
Lois asked a local crime reporter, Mike Gallagher, to investigate.
Lois wanted me to look into Kaitlyn's relationship with a boyfriend. Lois felt that there had been some real problems and that the police had failed to take a look at it.
Mike first spoke to Kate's former landlord.
I had the impression from neighbors that Kaitlyn was more afraid of her boyfriend's friends rather than her boyfriend. She would get disturbed when they only spoke Vietnamese around her. The friends caused friction between her and her boyfriend, and she did not like his friends.
Well, if they're your friends, how come you let them treat me so loud?
Things were much more stormy than we had ever guessed, and it wasn't just a little lover's spat. There was something very major happening in Kate's life after she moved in with her boyfriend, and she told us she was very sorry that she had ever let him move in with her. It had been a big mistake. She wanted him to move out so her girlfriend could move in instead.
Mike Gallagher was able to obtain a copy of the note that police believed Kate had left for her boyfriend on the day of the shooting. He compared it with another sample of her writing.
It was obvious just by comparing the handwritings of the note with Caitlin's writing that she did not write that note. That led me to believe that within hours of her shooting, her boyfriend was already lying to police.
The landlord also told Gallagher that on the night Kaitlyn died, three of her boyfriend's associates were in her apartment drinking. Kate's mother is convinced that one of them made the phone calls to the law firm in Orange County.
Who in the world would wait in that apartment to call Orange County to say she's dead? To call that particular paralegal? None of that makes sense to us.
Was Kaitlyn Arquette executed because she had learned too much about the insurance scam?
I don't think that the Vietnamese connection is related to this case. Thus far, I have not received any information and to indicate positively that the Vietnamese is involved in this homicide.
Trying to cooperate with you guys.
Police were going in a completely different direction. 6 months after the murder, an informant led police to a young man named Juvenal Escobedo.
The Arquette girl, the university girl again.
They discovered that Escobedo had recently sold his brown Chevrolet Camaro. They became suspicious. On the night of the murder, a truck driver had reported seeing a brown Camaro chasing a young woman in a car similar to Kaitlyn's. In the end, however, the charges were dropped because police could not connect Juvenal with the shooting.
We certainly appreciate you coming in and talking.
Finally,
to us again.
Under pressure from Kate's family, the police questioned her boyfriend again. This time, he admitted that he and a friend had taken part in the insurance scam. But charges have never been filed against him or any of his friends, nor is he considered a suspect in Kate's murder.
No, she never tried to throw me out.
Caitlin's boyfriend's friends were involved with large-scale organized criminal activity in Los Angeles and multi-million-dollar insurance frauds. I don't think the police ever took that seriously.
There seems to be two viable theories about who killed Kaitlyn. She was either the victim of a random shooting or she was executed to keep her from exposing the insurance scam.
Our family doesn't have any real idea who pulled the trigger on Kate. The one thing we feel very strong about is that she was not shot randomly, as just people out on a spree having fun shooting a pretty girl in a red car. We believe Kate was killed because she was going to talk, was going to expose illegal activities involving her boyfriend and his companions.
Update. There are new developments in this case, and here's one of our staff with details.
In 2021, Paul Apodaca, who was being held on a parole violation, confessed to multiple homicides and sexual assaults, including the murder of Kaitlyn Arquette. He is charged with the murder of Althea Oakley and remains behind bars while investigators work to confirm his involvement in Kaitlyn's murder.
Next, Georgia Rudolph is haunted by dreams and memories from another time and possibly another life. Marietta, Ohio. Georgia Rudolph describes a startling dream.
I feel the cold. I feel the night. I smell the horses. I smell the leather. I can feel the girl, but it feels like myself climbing on this carriage and going down the road, and I can hear the sound of the horses' hoofs.
The dictionary defines reincarnation as, quote, the rebirth of a soul in a new body. But is reincarnation possible? And can anyone actually prove that they lived a previous life? Well, Georgia Rudolph believes that she can.
There was a little girl and a younger woman in all of Georgia's visions. The time and the place are not familiar. Sometimes they appear as dreams, but more often than not as distinct memories. They describe events that she hasn't experienced. At least, not in this life.
There never seemed to be a common denominator of what would trigger off the memories. As a child, I don't think there was a month that went by that I didn't have either memories or dreams.
Georgia was only 5 when the memories began.
I used to draw a picture of this girl. I also drawn a picture of a house since I was 5. And then the house would go with the girl. And if I didn't get her right, I would erase her or tear it up and start all over again. I knew exactly how this girl was supposed to look. I have always known that face.
As Georgia grew older, the incidents became more frequent. Often, they were no more than a quick flash. But all of her visions seemed to come from the distant past, from the early 1900s. There were no cars or planes. But there were repeated images of paddle wheel steamers, which Georgia, in her own lifetime, had never even seen.
It's not like a childhood memory. It feels different. It's like taking a picture from my mind, projecting it on a screen, and just replaying it over and over.
A river played a large part in George's dreams. So did a young man dressed in a brown suit, wearing a derby hat. Sometimes he was alone. Sometimes he was with the girl. And always there were the images of a horse-drawn carriage on a cold winter night.
When Georgia first contacted me, I felt it might be something like an early traumatic childhood memory that she was trying to remember or re-experience, Or possibly it could be an aspect of a multiple personality where she was imagining herself or experiencing herself to be someone different, which sometimes happens in these cases. Other than that, the reincarnation was probably the last thing in my mind about what had happened to her. So we're going to go through a procedure this evening.
Dr. Douglas Smith began regressive hypnosis with Georgia. This type of therapy allows the patient to go back in time, but still remember everything.
I'd like you to take a very slow, deep breath.
For our story, Georgia agreed to once again undergo hypnosis.
He asked me a question and referred to me as Georgia. I remember very vividly saying, "I don't know who you're talking to." And he said, "Well, if this isn't Georgia, then who is it?" And I remember saying, "My name is Sandra Jean Jenkins."
In what year were you born, Sandra?
1895.
Georgia came to believe that the face she had drawn so many times had a name. Sandra Jean Jenkins. This was the girl in her memories and her dreams. In further sessions, Georgia filled in the details of her visions. She could now clearly see Sandra Jean on a paddle wheel steamer. One of the men on the boat was the young man in the derby hat. His name was Tommy Hicks. He and Sandra were sweethearts. The sessions also revealed that the two of them were about to be married.
Georgia seems to me a very down-to-earth person. Yeah. And it surprised me when she came out with the amount of emotion and affect and details that she did under hypnosis.
When this came out, not only did I feel I was crazy, it scared me to death. It went against everything that I have ever been taught as far as religion goes.
She is very sincere in her belief that she actually subjectively experienced all the things that she has experienced in that past life that she described. She's not faking or pretending. It is a real experience for her.
Were the visions that haunted Georgia Rudolph for more than 30 years proof of reincarnation? Coming up, Georgia finds unexplained connections between her dreams and the real life of Sandra Jean Jenkins. For more than 30 years, Georgia Rudolph was haunted by dreams of a girl named Sandra Jean Jenkins. Under hypnosis, she was repeatedly drawn to the town of Marietta, Ohio. Georgia decided to visit, hoping to see if there was any truth to her dreams. Georgia arranged to meet with a reporter named Ted Bauer. He was a lifelong resident of Marietta and had worked for the local newspaper for 32 years.
When George arrived in Marietta, I said, "I'll take you around and show you some of the places you talked about over the phone." And she says, "No, I'll show you where to go."
I remember this place.
Ted was amazed when Georgia stopped in front of an insurance company and began describing the interior of an ice cream parlor. The ice cream parlor had closed in 1937, 11 years before Georgia was even born.
I remember the tile inside. It was like red and white.
She described the interior almost perfectly.
And it was tile.
I checked this with the son of the man who had run it for years. In a way, it seems crazy, but what do you do? She was accurate about her descriptions. I was just baffled by her. She has some kind of power, some way of knowing what happened in the past. I don't know what the power would be, but she has it.
When I began to understand that I was being 100% correct, there was a fright, but there was an excitement that was starting to build in me. It was like this is really real. I really was this girl.
Despite her vivid memories, Georgia could find no record whatsoever of a Sandra Jean Jenkins in Marietta. And so she continued her search 5 miles to the north in the small farming town of Newport, Ohio. And you guessed it, she knew her way around this town too.
The first thing I saw when entering Newport was a big gray house. It sent chills through my body. This is my house. This is where I lived. I could see a room, and I knew that this had been her bedroom. This was the house that Sandra had lived in.
Throughout George's life, one dream had always stood out as more haunting than all the others. In it, she saw Sandra Jean as a young girl alone on the steps of a church.
In the dream, I know she has to walk exactly 2 blocks, and she's standing in front of a cemetery. And there's a path that goes off to the right, and it curves and twists in different directions. And then the path eventually straightens out. And when she gets to the point where it straightens out, she's on the side of a hill looking down on a grave, which I know to be her grandmother's grave. But I'm never able to get the name off of the headstone, because it's that point that I wake up.
In Newport, Georgia found the church from her dream. Perhaps now she could find out the identity of Sandra Jean's grandmother.
I walked the 2 blocks that I knew I had to walk in my dream, and I found myself in the cemetery, and I started walking this path, and as I walked it, it began to dawn on me, this is the path in my dreams. And when I stopped where the dream stops, I was looking down on the grave that I knew to be my grandmother's. And it said, Mary Bevan Green. And I finally got a name.
The gravestone provided the missing link to the house Georgia had seen in her dream. In the early 1900s, this house had been the home of the Green family. They had also owned a fleet of paddle wheel steamers that worked the Ohio River. Now the story of Sandra Jean Jenkins and Tommy Hicks became clear.
I want you to allow yourself to go back a little bit further.
Under
now.
Hypnosis, Georgia recalled that just days before Sandra Jean and Tommy were to be married, he was swept overboard in a storm on the Ohio River. His body was never found. Sandra Jean Jenkins was left alone, and to her family's dismay, she discovered that she was pregnant with Tommy's child.
Tommy's gone. Mama will never forgive me.
I want you to move forward in time. You are now at the river. And I want you to describe to me what you did then.
I take my locket off. And I slide into the water. And I walk.
Where are you buried?
They put me up on a hill, close to the family, but not with the family.
Georgia is convinced that because Sandra Jean took her own life, she was buried in an unmarked grave a few feet away from her grandmother. Under hypnosis, Georgia said that from Sandra Jean's grave,
you can see an angel with one arm raised up. When she looked south from Mary Green's grave, Georgia saw the statue of an angel, its right arm extended upward. Georgia's discoveries in Ohio do seem convincing, but is there any real proof that Sandra Jenkins or Tommy Hicks ever existed? Georgia couldn't find a record of Tommy, but she did find his parents.
When I was under hypnosis, I had said that Tommy's parents' names were Tom and Jenny Hicks. That in 1906, there is a farm registered to Tom and Jenny Hicks in Newport, Ohio.
Georgia also located the Green family's nearest living relatives, who gave her evidence that Sandra Jean Jenkins actually existed.
They brought out a picture taken in 1908. It's a family reunion picture. And the girl that I call Sandra, that I have drawn my entire life, is standing in that picture. There was a statement made by a member of the family. I don't know this girl's name, but I know she drowned out back of the house.
In the family photograph, the girl from George's dreams seems to be standing slightly apart from those around her. The photograph includes a roster of names. Every single person is identified except the girl Georgia recognized as Sandra Jean.
In terms of whether reincarnation is a real fact or not, as a scientist, I don't know. I want proof. I'm a doubter. But as a human being, I would love to have it be the truth.
I believe that reincarnation is real, but I'm not sure what reincarnation is. I know there's something to it. I have had an experience that a lot of people don't get to have. My logic oftentimes will tell me, no, this isn't real. But my heart tells me, yes, it is.
Could the story of Sandra Jean Jenkins be the result of an overactive imagination? Or is it proof of reincarnation? Or maybe it's something else. Something we can't explain. Next, a serial rapist who brought terror to a small college town is finally back behind bars. Texas A&M University. With more than 45,000 students, this campus provided the perfect cover for a serial rapist. He hid his violent intentions behind a normal college life. On the night of the first attack, he was just the jogger who looked like any other student.
When the jogger ran by the victim, he ran out of sight, then turned around and came back. She didn't feel at that time that that was really strange, because of the fact that there are a lot of joggers that go to a certain area, they'll turn around, they come back, and they may come back the same way, or they may continue a different route.
Hey.
Hi.
Chilly evening tonight.
Yeah, it's... The coffee!
This is a knife!
The suspect kept telling the victim to do what he told her to do. He also kept that knife within her sight, and she had every indication at that point that he would use that knife on her.
30 minutes later, the rapist disappeared into the shadows. University police soon released a composite sketch and a character profile of the suspect.
He was probably a college student. He would strike again. He would use that knife. We had to catch this guy. We had to identify him. We had to find out where he was, and we had to prevent him from performing another sexual assault.
The profile was right on target. 3 months later,
the knife-wielding assailant struck again.
From nowhere, she said, a knife appeared and was placed against her throat. He threatened her. He told her that if she screamed, he was going to kill her. And therefore, she complied with his instructions. He then took her to a nearby field. There was about 5 foot tall grass, and he had already matted down a 6 foot diameter area so that the grass was real low, which is where he then sexually assaulted her. The site was chosen, but not necessarily the victim. He just waited for the right one to come by and then took her to the location that he had already prepared.
This composite is based on the second victim's description. When compared with the first drawing, investigators knew that a serial rapist was stalking the campus.
We became very concerned that if it was indeed the same person, if he had committed one and committed a second, there was most likely going to be a third and a fourth and so on until he was stopped.
Authorities covered the campus with posters. However, the description could have fit almost any male student. Straight hair, not curly. Young, not old. White, not black.
A lot of people end up saying, yeah, looks like just any regular person. Even the second victim that I had interviewed in depth, she made the comment too, just looked like a clean-cut student.
The critical break came from the first victim when 10 months after the assault, she stopped for groceries at a local market.
Have a good day. Thanks. Howdy, how you doing? Hey.
Fine, thanks.
This is a knife. Do what I say, and I won't hurt you. We're gonna go for a little walk. Okay?
Okay.
The young woman was convinced that she was now face to face with the man who raped her.
That'll be $42.57, please.
Can I write you a check?
Sure.
Let's go!
This is a knife! Can I see your driver's license, please?
Driver's license?
Yeah. Thank you. Excuse me. Hey! You forgot something.
Police soon learned that the clerk's name was Don Richard Davis, Jr. He was scheduled to graduate from Texas A&M in just 3 weeks.
Detective Villarreal, this is Detective Lindholm with the Texas A&M University Police Department.
Hi. We're investigating the two rapes that took place on the campus last year. Your name came to us as a lookalike.
Yeah.
His demeanor, his posture, even his physical countenance was very timid, very sheepish. But interesting enough, we started to really study that picture and look at him. And you started to really look in those eyes. They didn't match the sheepish behavior we had seen. The eyes ended up reflecting a very thoughtful, aware, focused individual.
When this photograph of Davis was shown to the second victim, she also identified him as the rapist. DNA evidence was the clincher. Davis was arrested and charged with 2 counts of aggravated sexual assault.
You gotta let me call my parents.
He was released on $150,000 bail and ordered to stay with his parents and observe a 10 p.m. curfew. But 6 days before the start of his trial, Davis did not come home. Update. Soon after our story aired, Don Richard Davis Jr. was arrested by police in Cleveland, Ohio. Davis pleaded guilty to 2 counts of aggravated sexual assault. He was sentenced to 99 years in prison and will not be eligible for parole until 2030. Coming up, an aviation expert believes he has solved the mystery of Amelia Earhart's final flight. Saline County, Arkansas. On a hot August evening, Don Henry and Kevin Ives set out for some night hunting along the railroad tracks behind Don's home. 4 hours later, the engineer of a freight train traveling at more than 50 miles an hour spots what he thinks are two people stretched across the tracks.
And I started laying down on the diesel horn. And I got no reaction, none at all. Not so much as a flinch.
Don and Kevin were lying parallel on the tracks. They were partially covered by a light green tarp, and beside them lay Don's .22 caliber rifle. After a brief investigation, the state medical examiner ruled that their deaths were accidental. To prosecutor Richard Garrett, the death of Don Henry and Kevin Ives looked like murder. He received permission for a second autopsy. This time, the results reveal that Kevin had been stabbed in the back by a large knife, and Don had been hit in the face with a rifle butt. Garrett now believes that both boys were either unconscious or dead before the train ever hit them.
I think that the boys saw something that they shouldn't have seen. And it had to do with drugs, either with a crank lab, which manufactures methamphetamine, or certain individuals involved in those matters. And those people felt like that the information that the boys then had was such that they could not allow them to live.
Update. Since we broadcast this story, Don Henry's t-shirt has been analyzed by an expert pathologist. Cuts in the fabric indicate that Don was stabbed before the train ran over him. In the light of this new evidence, the grand jury changed its ruling from probable homicide to definite homicide. If you have any information about the deaths of Don Henry and Kevin Ives, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. One of the most intriguing stories we have ever profiled is the mystery of legendary aviator Amelia Earhart. After we first broadcast her story, researcher Richard Gillespie announced to the world that he had finally solved the mystery of her last flight. 70 years ago, Amelia Earhart earned the admiration of the entire world. At a time when flying was an all-male club, Amelia Earhart became an all-American hero. On May 20th, 1937, Amelia and her navigator, Fred Noonan, began a daring attempt to fly around the world in this twin-engine Lockheed 10 Electra. On July 2nd, they disappeared trying to find tiny Howland Island in the South Pacific. A massive search turned up no trace of Amelia, Fred, or their airplane. They were officially declared lost at sea. Update.
We're heard throughout the Pacific.
1 year after we first broadcast this story, aviation researcher Richard Gillespie called a press conference. He claimed to have found physical evidence proving that Amelia Earhart and Fred Noonan died on a small island waiting to be rescued.
Before you are artifacts which, along with recently discovered historical documents, conclusively solve the disappearance of Amelia Earhart.
Gillespie found artifacts on a tiny island located 420 miles from Howland Island, Earhart's original destination. Among the items that Gillespie displayed were these tattered remnants of a shoe, allegedly worn by Earhart. He also found this piece of aluminum, which he claims came from Earhart's Lockheed 10 Electra.
The rivet pattern is the same.
If Richard Gillespie is correct, then the final chapter of Amelia Earhart's story can be written. However, Gillespie's evidence has been questioned by several experts. Elgin Long, a noted historian and Earhart biographer, was asked by Gillespie to study detailed measurements and photographs of the wreckage. Long and his team compared the evidence with an airplane identical to Amelia Earhart's.
We made a template that was the exact same size and had all the rivet holes in it, just like the fragment that was found on Nicomororo. We put this template up to the bottom of the airplane, and we compared the rivet lines with the rivets on the actual airplane.
You notice that there's no row of fasteners along.
They didn't match at all.
Also notice that
there was rivet holes where there shouldn't be any rivets, and there weren't rivet holes where there should be rivets.
Elgin Long compared the template to nearly every section of the airplane. No match could be found.
Yeah, there's no way that piece could have come from a Lockheed 10 or Amelia Earhart's airplane.
Richard Gillespie claims that the rivet patterns don't match because repairs were made to Earhart's plane during her first attempt to fly around the world. A Lockheed engineer, Ed Werner, disagrees. He argues that all repairs made on Earhart's plane were done to strict factory specs.
The repair had to be exactly per the engineering orders. At first, I was kind of happy that this controversy was over, but then very disappointed now to come to the conclusion that it can't be part of her airplane.
Richard Gillespie stands by his claim that the fragment he found came from Amelia Earhart's plane, but aviation experts disagree. For now, at least, the legendary disappearance of Amelia Earhart remains an unsolved mystery.